Hi there again, sports fans. This is Les Kiter about to bring you play-by-play the second game of the 1966 Dream World Series. It's the American versus the National League All-Stars, the most popular players of the past and present, chosen from thousands of ballots by fans all over the country. Through the magic of the giant Cardone Computing Center at the famed Franklin Institute in Philadelphia, you'll hear how the great baseball stars of today and yesterday might have fared had they met on the playing field in the best 4 out of 7 games. All the color, all the drama of the world's greatest spectacle will be brought to you on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.
Hello again, everybody. This is Bill Mazur with Les. The Dream World Series is brought to you by Ballantine Beer. Hey, friend, do it again. Ballantine Beer. And by Aurora Plastics. Dreams come true with hobby kits by Aurora. And by Prestone Antifreeze. Never pick up a stranger. Always pick up Prestone Antifreeze Coolant. Ready for the second game of the Dream World Series? Here again is Les Kiter.
It's a sunny afternoon at Ebbets Field in Brooklyn as we prepare for game 2, which is almost ready to start. The umpires have already completed their discussion at home plate with John McGraw, the manager for the National League All-Stars, and representing Connie Mack, Joe McCarthy was at home plate, representing the American Leaguers, and the National League Ball Club is already out on the playing field, and Christy Mathewson is completing his warm-up tosses down in the American League bullpen. Now, we're just about ready to start, so quickly we want to get into the starting lineup. First for the American League team. Bob Feller, who will be the starting pitcher, we're watching him now. He was just chatting in front of the dugout with Christy Mathewson, who has now moved on out to the playing field and will be the starting pitcher. The battery for this ball game for the American League, Bob Feller and Yogi Berra. And for the National League, Christy Mathewson and Roy Campanella. Now, quickly, the batting order for the American League. Leading off in left field, Ty Cobb. Same batting order as yesterday. Batting second, Charlie Gehringer at second base. Hitting third, Babe Ruth in right field. The cleanup hitter is Luke Gehrig, first base. Batting number 5, Joe DiMaggio, center field. And what a day he had in Ebbets Field yesterday with a single, double, triple, and walk. Batting number 6, the Yogi man, Larry Berra, the catcher for the Yankees. Batting 7th, Brooks Robinson, the Baltimore Oriole third baseman. Hitting 8th, Phil Rizzuto, shortstop, who today is one of 5 Yankees in the starting batting order of 9. And hitting 8th, Robert Feller of the Cleveland Indians. The battery again is Feller and Berra. For the National League, same batting order as yesterday, when they pulled it out in 13 innings to win that ball game 3-2. Koufax striking out 11, walking only 5 to prevail in that game over Walter Johnson, who had 6 strikeouts. The batting order, Rogers Hornsby, second base for the National League leading off. Stan Musial, left field. The crowd applauding as Campanella runs out to their final bit of instructions from Christie before they get ready to start. Batting 3rd, Willie Mays, center field. The cleanup hitter, Mel Ott, in right. Batting 5th, another ex-Giant manager, Bill Terry, at first base. Pye Trainer, the third baseman of the Pirates, is batting 6th. Here's Campanella putting the mask on. He leads back to say something to the home plate umpire. Batting 7th, Roy Campanella. Hitting 8th, Honus Wagner at shortstop. And pitching, Christy Mathewson. Mathewson and Campanella the battery. Ty Cobb about to step in. And now, ladies and gentlemen, here is Edwin Franco Goldman and his famed concert band to play our national anthem. We'll be right back. Crowd reacting to Ty Cobb as he emerges now and moves toward the plate.
We'll get underway with today's game in just a moment on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.
Isn't this fantastic, fans? Playing baseball by computer? Man, that's quite a machine. Just feed it questions and information, and just like that, you've got the right answer. I'll tell you what. What do you say we give it a between-inning test? How about this for a question? What beer has the flavor that says, "Hey, friend, do it again"? Let's feed that to the computer. It's lighting up, it's flashing, and here's our answer. Ballantine beer. Today's Ballantine. Big and bright, crisp and light. Today's Ballantine beer is the greatest ever. Tastes so smooth and easy going down. Yes, sir, a big glass of Ballantine is the right answer anytime to a big thirst. Pour a glass and see for yourself. Just one taste and you'll agree. Ballantine's got the flavor that says, "Hey, friend, do it again." Ballantine beer. Say, what's this? That computer is lighting up again. It's got another message for us, and here it is. Pick up a six-pack of Ballantine beer next time you're out. Today's Ballantine beer. Yes, sir. Today's Ballantine beer. Let's get back to Les.
You know, when Cobb strides to the plate, he always creates a tension in the opposing team. They said that Ty in his career always set the terms of the game. The men in the field were his enemies. They threatened his batting leadership, and Ty Cobb gives nobody any quarter and expects none. His was a declared war against anyone who threatens his position, and he never fails to let them know it. There's Ty moving into the batter's box. Although relaxed at the plate, he's termed always a nervous batter. Fusses and fumes up there. He failed to hit in the opener yesterday, struck out three times, so you know his present disposition. Stands on the left side of the batter's box, hunched shoulders forward, crowding the plate. And ready on that mound is Christy Mathewson. Going into his windup now. The pride of John J. McGraw deals a first pitch in and over, called strike one, and we're underway with game two. The National League leading 1-0. The umpires in this game today, Babe Pennelly is the home plate umpire. Cal Hubbard is at first. Here's a swing and a miss at the next pitch on Ty Cobb. He backs out. At third base is Bill Clem, the arbitrator who worked the plate yesterday, and Major Kurth in right field, Bill Connolly in left. Cobb, the batter, first inning. On the mound, Christy Mathewson. All right, he cranks up and deals. The pitch is swung on, and there's a low line drive into right field. Base hit. Clean single to right field. Ty Cobb opens up, as he does so frequently in baseball, with a sharp base hit. Frequently, but not yesterday. He was 0 for 7. Here's Charlie Gehringer, the smooth second baseman. The key to Giant success over the years out there in the mound, Christy Mathewson, who shares with Grover Alexander, you know, the record for total National League victories, 373. However, Alex lost 20 more than Matty. Gehringer had two base hits yesterday, won a double. Left-hand batter infield looking for the possible bunt with Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig to follow. Pitch to Gehringer, a homer in for a called strike, and he wasn't offering. 0-1 with Cobb at first, and of course with Tyrus at first base, look out at second. He comes in with those spikes high. Christy Mathewson with, as we mentioned, more victories than any other National League pitcher, 373, but he's lost 20 less than Grover Alexander. Right throw to first, Cobb back, no tag play. Coaching on the lines for the American Leaguers is Frank Crosetti down there at third, and Jimmy Dykes at first base. Gehringer, your batter. Will he hit, will he bunt? Guess now, don't second guess. Up there leveling with the bat, Cobb at first. The pitch swung on, there's a high fly ball hit into shallow left center field. Either man can get it, Musial and Mays converging, and Stan Musial hauls it in, Cobb holds it first. So Gehringer, instead of bunting, lofted the ball into the ozone, and the left fielder Musial hold it in. Here's the Babe coming up. If there ever were a greater hitter, no one in this crowd knows it. Babe had one bingle yesterday off the wall for a double. On first, Cobb, one down. First pitch called strike one. Babe Ruth batting left-handed, of course. They love to see Babe hit one out and trot around the bases. Here at Ebbets Field, it's only 297 down that right field line to the big wall with the screen atop it. And I imagine the kids are out in Bedford Avenue with Babe Ruth up there and Gehrig to follow. Here's a floater high for a ball, 1-1. One ball, one strike. At first, Cobb, one out, first inning, no score, second game. Brains, the ability to pace himself, exceptional control, and a freak pitch that he called the fadeaway. The principal sources of the greatness of Christy Mathewson out there. The little Napoleon, John McGraw, drove all his players as if they were oxen, but never had to tell Matty anything twice. Pitch to Ruth, fouled back, and the count's 1-2. 1-2, 1 out, Cobb at first. The great Matty out there on the mound, Christy Mathewson. And of course, John McGraw's success based a great deal on the pitching success of this guy. All right, the pitch to Babe Ruth outside for a ball, and the count 2-2, and Ruth calls time, steps out. We said that McGraw, who's over there in the dugout, never had to tell Mathewson anything twice. The baseball annals record an incident early in the career when he lost a game to the Cubs in the ninth inning when a Jimmy Slagle, a notorious fastball hitter, drove a pitch like that out of the park, and McGraw didn't say anything, but approached Christy in the dugout the next day. Here's a swing and a foul back to Ruth, and it's still 2-2. Approached him in the dugout and said, "Don't you know that Slagle murders a fastball?" Matty answered, "No, I didn't know. The catcher called for the pitch and I gave it my best." And McGraw shouted, "Don't ever throw him one again." Mathewson didn't. The pitch to Ruth, swung on and missed, strike three, and Babe Ruth tried to hit that one across the bridge into Manhattan. Ruth took a terrific cut, the pitch inside, and strikeout number 1 in the ballgame for Mathewson. 2 men are out now. Cobb still at first base. 2 men out. And here is the Iron Horse, Lou Gehrig. And the outfield doesn't shift a bit. Ott is over at the line near the wall. Mace is in right center deep. Lou had a couple of bingos yesterday. Struck out once. He was 2-for-6. 13-inning opener in this series. And the National League, of course, has the edge with a 1-game lead. And they're going with Mathewson, who delivers to Gehrig over the corner for a called strike. 2 down, first inning, no score. All right, up on that mound, the look at first base. And Mathewson's delivery is swung on. A ground ball hit to the second baseman. Rogers Hornsby scoops it up over to first in time. And Gehrig is out, and so are the American Leaguers in the first inning. A 4-3 play, and Cobb opened with a single, was left stranded. Thus, in the first inning, for the American League, no runs, 1 hit, no errors, no man left. We go to the bottom of the first inning. The score, American League nothing, and the National League coming to bat on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.
Thank you very much, Les. Friends, this is not the challenge round, but here's a question that'll probably stump you. What is the largest participant sport going? Golf, you say. Bowling? Would you believe badminton? Well, the answer, surprisingly, model car racing, the sport of racing miniature cars on a miniature track. The Aurora Plastics Corporation popularized the concept some 6 years ago under the name of model motoring in the HO scale. Today, about 35 million models later, the smallest cars are bigger than ever. If you're a model motoring fan, you don't have to be reminded of the exciting advantages of owning your own HO set by Aurora. Ease of assembly and operation, twice the action and half the space. Lightning-fast Thunderjet cars. Aurora now has 30 different models that can be bought separately, including a 67 Ford T-Bird and dozens of super realistic accessories to make your layout more and more lifelike. As we say, you get more zoom and less room with model motoring. Model motoring in the HO scale. By Aurora. We go to the bottom half of inning number 1. Hornsby, Musial, and Mays against Bob Feller. Here's Les Kiter.
It's the bottom of inning number 1 on the shores of the Gowanus Canal in Flatbush, Ebbetsfield in Brooklyn. Game 2 in the Dream World Series, with the National League leading by 1. Here's Rogers Hornsby coming in to lead off against the fastest pitcher in the business, Bobby Feller. Rapid rubber to the Indians out on the mound. The team switch tomorrow and will be in Scheib Park in Philadelphia for Game 3. Home of the Athletics of Connie Mack, who's over there in that first base dugout. All right, up with the bat level, Rogers Hornsby. On the mound, Bob Feller, who throws nothing but smoke. Casts off the first pitch. It's in and over for a called strike. In yesterday's opening ball game, Hornsby had 1 base hit. 1-for-6. feller with that big leg kick deals a fast curve high. Ball one. It's one ball, one strike. Leadoff hitter Hornsby on deck. Musial, the outfield, plays him almost straight away. DiMaggio, a shade to right center. Bright, sunshiny day and less breeze than we had yesterday. Hornsby up there with that big bat. Rogers calls time for a moment, steps out of the box. Calling the balls and strikes is little Babe Pinelli today. He called the perfect game in the World Series, of course, that Don Larson threw, which was his final regular season job. Hornsby played from 1915 through 37. Lifetime average only 358. He hit over 400 three times. Right-hand sticker up there with that bat. All right, the pitch. There's a high fly ball hit deep into center field. DiMaggio going back. He'll never get this one. The ball over his head, and it's rolling to the deep part of center field at Ebbets Field. Bounces off the wall. Hornsby around second. You should see him run. Here comes the relay throw. Hornsby on his way to third, and he'll go in standing with a triple. Rogers, Hornsby unloaded a tremendous drive. Hornsby unloads a long triple over the head of Joe DiMaggio, and anytime you hit the ball over the Yankee Clipper's head, that ball has been wheeled. All right, here's Musial up, the infield in now. No score, bottom of the first inning. Stan the man, the left fielder, batting left-handed. The right fielder, Babe Ruth, over near the line and up against the wall. He's almost leaning against it. DiMaggio's near the scoreboard in right center. Infield wants to cut the runoff. Hornsby at third. The pitch to Stan Musial in for a called strike one. On the mound is Bob Feller. Feller goes to the rosin sack. November 3rd, 1918, in Van Meter, Iowa, is when Bobby arrived. A farm boy learned to throw with his father out in the behind the barn on that Van Meter farm. Look at third base now. Pitch to Stan Musial is outside. The count goes to one ball, one strike. And Bob Feller, of course, with that terrific leg kick. Game two of the Dream World Series. No score in the bottom of the first inning. Bob Feller certainly endowed with all the physical equipment that the modern sport of baseball demanded. He was 16 years old in 1935 when the Indians first signed him. He delivers to Musial, who swings and fouls the ball into the net. One ball, two strikes. In his career, he only struck out 2,581 batters. One and two, the count on Musial. Hornsby at third, nobody out, infield in. Feller checks his runner. Delivers, swing and a miss, strike three. And Musial, who hits in this park like he owns it, goes down swinging, first time up against the speed of Bob Feller. And now stepping in, the Say Hey Kid, Willie Mays. Center field, who started in the Polo Grounds, moved to Seal Stadium and thence to Candlestick Park in San Francisco. Willie Mays, the asterisk after his name in the record book, the most prolific home run hitter of right-handers of all time. He had more home runs than any right-hand hitter in the history of baseball. Yesterday, he had trouble getting the ball out of the infield. He didn't. He made a great catch. He takes a fast curve inside corner, strike called. Feller, blazing fast. One out. Hornsby still at third. Infield still in. Mays the hitter. Bottom of the first. All right, Feller toes that rubber now. Takes a stretch. And delivers. Swing and a miss. Ground ball. Pass the mound. Out over second into center to base. Hit the run is in. Boy, that one went out like a blue dart. We thought he missed it. And the ball sailed right past the mound on the ground. In the center. One run in. And the National League draws first blood in the first inning. And the fans at Ebbets Field are really celebrating a May Day out here as Mays set the ball into the outfield. Well, that's the way it happens when a sportscaster says he didn't hit a ball out of the infield yesterday. And then, boom, next pitch. One run in, and it's a 1-0 ball game. May's first RBI. Here's Mel Ott, right fielder, left-hand batter. Infield at double play depth now. Pitch to Mel Ott, in for a strike. Feller working, has given up a triple and a single. No activity in the bullpen. Boy, May's hit that ball. You don't have to hit that speed very hard. Just meet the ball. Ott, of course, won the game in the bottom of the 13th yesterday with his third hit of the ball game, and it went for three bases. Pitch is low to Mel, 1-1. Some of the writers after the game were questioning whether or not Mel might have had an inside the park home run had it been necessary. But of course, when he hit third, the run was home and it was over. Here's Feller's delivery. Ott swings and misses at a wrinkle, and it's 1-2. He threw the curve. Milne hit 304 in his lifetime, started in 26, finished in 47, and of course was a manager of the Giants. Master Melvin. One out, one on, one in. Inning one, the score 1-0. Block of aces. Pitch fouled right at his feet. Boy, he took a cut at that one. Count remains 1-2. Feller with a new baseball turns his back on the infield, looks out in left center where the fans out in those double-deck stands at Ebbets Field have filled every seat. In the heart of Flatbush, it's 1-0 for the National Leaguers. Off first base, Mays, Ott the batter. The pitch to Mel is swung on and missed, strike three, and Bob Feller gets his second strikeout. No pitcher in baseball ever struck out more than Bobby Feller in his heyday. And he's showing his speed out here early today. He's already fanned Musial and Ott. And here's Bill Terry, another left-hand hitter, with two down. Mays at first and a run in. Bob Feller delivers a sharp breaking curve strike call. 0-1. In one season, Bob Feller's contract called for more money than had ever been paid a baseball player in the history of the game. And that was because of that attendance bonus. He delivers outside to Terry. Memphis Bill Terry up with two out and a runner at first, trying to get more runs as the National League leads 1-0. The year that he had so much money, his base pay was $55,000, but with his attendance bonus, he had $32,000 more. And they broke it down over $4,300 a game, $291 for each inning, and $97.10 for each man he retired. That was the bonus clause for Feller. All right, the pitch now to Terry is swung on, and there's a lazy fly hit high to right field. Babe Ruth should have no trouble. The Bambino over near the line shades his eyes from the sun and hauls it in for the out as Terry lifted it deep to right along the line. And thus in the bottom of inning number one for the National Leaguers, it's one run. Two hits, no errors, the man left. And at the end of inning number one on the scoreboard, it's all National League in front on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.
A very unusual bottom half of the first inning for the National League. You noticed, of course, that Feller got Musial and Ott on strikeouts and Terry on a fly ball to right, three left-handed hitters, and had his trouble with Hornsby, a right-handed hitter who tripled off of him, and Mays, who singled. And on that basis, it's the National League 1 and the American League nothing. The same way it was last night when the National League led the American League 1-0 at the end of the first inning. Now we'll go to the top of inning number 2 with DiMaggio, Berra, and Robinson to face Christy Mathewson right after this word from Prestone.
Never pick up a stranger. Pick up Prestone antifreeze. Never pick up a stranger. Don't put your car in danger. Now's the time, the right time to change her. Pick up Prestone antifreeze.
Get total protection with Prestone antifreeze. Prestone antifreeze, with its exclusive magnetic film, protects against freeze-ups, against rust and corrosion. Substitutes just aren't the same. So remember,
never pick up a stranger. Don't put your car in danger. Now's the time, the right time to change her. Pick up Prestone antifreeze.
Never pick up a stranger. Pick up Prestone antifreeze. Prestone antifreeze coolant is a product of Union Carbide.
And now let's pause for station identification.
WNBC, AM and FM, New York.
Bless, it's all yours. Inning number 2.
Round of applause greets Jolting Joe DiMaggio, who had those three big base hits yesterday as we start inning number 2. DiMaggio, Berra, and Robinson to follow in that order here in the top of the second with the National League in front, 1-0. And Christy Mathewson out there on the hill. DiMaggio, right-hand batter. That spread stance takes the first pitch in and over for a called strike one. Joe DiMaggio, the batter, outfield straight away in center and right. Musial is shaded toward the line in left field. Christy Mathewson, who of course had extraordinary control all during his career. During the 1913 season, remember, he enjoyed one stretch 68 consecutive innings without a base on balls. That's the guy pitching to DiMaggio. All right, he delivers. Line drive, past third, into left field. There's a base hit. Musial over fast as DiMaggio turns first, holds on a quick throw from Musial into Hornsby. So DiMaggio continues to hit the cover off the ball in Ebbets Field, his fourth base hit in this series that's only in the second inning of the second ball game. More hits than anybody in the series so far. Here's Yogi Berra, who always hit well in this park. Millot back near the wall. Berra has hit seven of them over that wall in either All-Star games, World Series games, or preseason games between the Dodgers and Yankees. All right, infield looking for anything with Berra the batter. Yogi takes the first pitch by Christie over for a strike. Christie Mathewson, who enjoyed his biggest year in the year 1908, when he only won 37 games that season, walked only 42 batters in 416 innings. That's less than two a ball game, or less than one a ball game when you check it. All right, Bears, a quick throw to first. DiMaggio back as Bill Terry put the ball on him, and Joe with a quick slide is back in. Yogi Berra the hitter, the most notorious bad ball hitter in baseball. DiMaggio at first. This guy's hit a wild pitch out of the park. Not literally, but it's looked that way. All right, Yogi takes that practice swing. Pitch to DiMaggio, swung on. There's a high pop up to the infield. Bonus Wagner moving in toward the infield grass, now back on the skin part of the baseline, makes the catch. And Berra popped it high up into the air early in the day in Ebbets Field. That's no problem. Later in the day, when the shadows form, sometimes it's difficult to follow a pop up like that. Here's Brooks Robinson, the all-around fine ball player for the Baltimore Orioles. That's a nice hit. In yesterday's opening game, he was 1-for-3, but he walked three different times, giving Koufax fits up there. Robinson takes the first pitch by Mathewson over for a strike. One out, one on, second inning. It's 1-0 if you've tuned in late. The National League scoring in the bottom of the first inning. Pitch way high, almost got away from him. 2-0. Brooks Robinson the batter, ball two the count. One out, one on. Once again, Christie ready, stretches and fires a curve that breaks way outside, and only fast working a part of Campanella avoided a wild pitch. Ball three, and Campy now out in front of the batter, throws that ball back, snap throw to a fellow who has been the model of control through his career, Christie Mathewson. One out, DiMaggio the runner at first. All right, once again, Christie stretches. And the pitch, he lost him, outside, ball four. So there's a rarity in baseball, four balls in a row thrown by Mathewson. Another rarity, Brooks Robinson gets his fourth base on balls in this two-game series. And the American League now has the tying runner in scoring position. One out, Robinson at first, and the little scooter, Phil Rizzuto, the batter. One out, two men on. Rizzuto with the infield moved in slightly. Like a double play to get out of this if they can. Ready on that hill. The pitch, and it's over for a called strike. One out, two men on, third base open. The outfield shallow for Rizzuto. Mays is as shallow as you'll see a center fielder play. Number 10 on his back from the Yankees, Phil Rizzuto, batting eighth in the order with runners first and second and one away. National League in front, 1-0. Pitch swung on, and he sends a little ground ball dribbling into the ground. Here's the pitcher off the mound. Mathewson will have to hurry. Up throwing. He got him on a nice play. Phil Rizzuto almost had himself an infield hit. Boy, he swung around on that ball. It spun in the dirt, kicked along the line about a foot fair. Mathewson fielded the ball, had only one play, and threw to first to get him. However, the runners advanced. DiMaggio to third with a tying run potential. And Brooks Robinson to second, and Bobby Feller will be the batter. 1-3 put out if you keep score. Toby DeLuca has it on our score sheet already. Two on. DiMaggio at third, Robinson at second. Two runners in scoring position, and Feller could aid his own cause if he could belt one here. Ready on the mound now. The pitch is swung on. There's a fly ball hit into short left field. Musial on the run. Can he make it? Yes, Musial on the run toward the infield. And that's the out that retires the side as Bob Feller tried to drop one in there. A Texas leaguer that hung in the air, and Stan Musial, playing fairly shallow, came racing in to grab it. And Mr. Mathewson gets out of trouble with no runs, one hit, no errors, and two men left. We go to the bottom of the second inning with the National League 1, the American League nothing, on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.
Hey, friend, while Les and those computers cool off, let's you and I cool it with Ballantine, today's Ballantine beer. If you don't have today's Ballantine in your refrigerator, you are missing plenty. Big and bright, crisp and light. Today's Ballantine is the greatest ever. But don't take my word. Pour a glass and see for yourself. Just one glass, and you'll agree that Mazur's right. Ballantine's got the flavor that says, hey, friend, do it again. Ballantine beer.
Ballantine's got the flavor that says, hey, friend, do it again. Ballantine beer. Hey, friend, do it again. Ballantine beer. Good to start with Ballantine. Good to stay with Ballantine. The flavor's great at the three-ring sign. Ballantine's got the flavor that says, hey, friend, do it again. Ballantine, Ballantine beer.
Well, now that you and I have cooled off with that Ballantine beer, let's go to Les and find out what that Cardon computer has to say.
Bob Feller ready to go to work. Bottom of the second inning. Pie Trainer up there with a bat in his hand. And Rapid Robert cranks up and deals strike call. Trainer had one hit yesterday, a single in the ninth inning. When the National League tried to break that game open, they couldn't do it, but they finally did it in the 13th inning. Pie Trainer, the batter, bats right-handed. Ready on the mound now, the pitch. There's a low line drive past Feller, out over second into center, it's a base hit. Trainer opens the second inning with a shot to center. And the National League, wearing their batting clothes today, that's the third solid hit. And the crowd goes crazy in Ebbets Field as the batter is Roy Campanella, with Trainer on with a sharp single to center. Roy Campanella steps in, always a pride here in Brooklyn. He had himself two base hits in yesterday's opening game. At first base, Trainer, nobody out, infield, double play depth now, with Campanella with that big shillelagh. On the mound, ready to go to work, is Feller. Pitch, swung on a ground ball right back at the mound, off Feller's knee. The ball kicking over toward third base, and there's no play. It's a base hit. Everybody's safe. And hold everything, here comes Joe McCarthy out to see if Feller's hurt. Boy, oh boy, Campanella almost got himself a pitcher. A low line shot right back off the knee of Bob Feller. And McCarthy is out there with him. Trainer stopped at second as Feller went over to field the ball, had no chance to make a play anywhere. And thus the National Leaguers have two men on, nobody out. And the hand is for Bobby, he's okay, as McCarthy heads back to the American League dugout. Connie Mack, of course, stays in that dugout. But he was standing up there, scorecard and all, with alarm and concern on his face when that ball ricocheted off Feller's knee. Out in the bullpen, down in the left field corner, the American League bullpen, the biggest winner of all time, Cy Young, as Feller was hit on the knee that time. Trainer at second, Campanella at first. Now he's in trouble with nobody out. That's four hits off Feller in less than two innings here, and it's a 1-0 ball game, National League, as the Flying Dutchman, Honus Wagner, takes the first pitch on the hand, strike call. Wagner the batter. Runners first and second, nobody out in the second inning. Wagner with that bat level. All right, the pitch by Feller. Swung on it, ground ball, slowly hit out toward short. Here comes Rizzuto. The throw to first is too late. He beat the ball, The bases are loaded. Honus Wagner is on at first, and the bases are full. Oh, baby, did Wagner go down that line. Oh, Bowlegs is not noted for his speed, but he hit the ball off the handle and sent a slow roller toward short. Phil Rizzuto came in as fast as he could, had no chance to get anybody else through to first base, and can Wagner beat the throw? The Ducks are on as Trainer is at third. Campanella moves to second. Wagner is on at first. There's no batter now. Here he comes out of the dugout. Christy Mathewson, boy, could he aid his cause here. He has that jacket on, gives it to the bat boy, reaches down for a handful of dirt, talking to Hornsby, who's standing side of the plate now, slaps him on the back. And Mathewson, a right-hander all around, will bat with a bases full and nobody out in the second inning. One of the truly dramatic moments of this World Series so far. The tail end of the batting order. Three straight base hits. Trainer, Campanella, and Wagner, and they're all on the pond out there. As Mathewson stands in and takes the first pitch over for a strike. Runner at third, Trainer. Runner at second, Campy. Runner at first, Wagner. Nobody out. Natty up with a bat, and the score 1-0 National League. All right, the infield at double play depth, although they may fire that ball to the plate to prevent a run, you never can tell. Mathewson with a bat leveled now. Bobby Feller free to wind up. He delivers. Pitch swung on a line drive. Hit. Trainer scores. Here's Campanella around third. DiMaggio up with the ball. Campanella is coming in to score. The throw going to third, and Wagner holds at second base. Two runs are in, and it's a 3-0 ball game. Oh, baby, did Christie help out his own cause. Christie Mathewson stepped into the Feller fastball and lined it into left center field in the alley. Only the speed of foot of Joe DiMaggio kept that ball from going through for extra bases, scoring Trainer. And scoring Campanella, two runs are in, and the score, the National League 3, the American League nothing. Here in the second inning, runners first and second, and they're talking to Bobby Feller now. A whole infield around him. Four consecutive base hits by the last four men in the National League batting order. Two of the infield variety, but one of them was savagely hit, Campy's. Wagner hit a little bleeder and beat it out, but Christie Mathewson hit the first pitch. A sinking line drive into left center field between two of the greatest defensive outfielders of all time, the Georgia Peach and the Yankee Clipper. DiMaggio fielded the ball one-handed in left center and fired to third base, holding Wagner at second, but he couldn't stop the runs. Here's strike call to Hornsby after the breakup on that mound. They're leaving Feller in there, but Cy Young is heating up now in the bullpen. Four consecutive hits, and you know that's a half a dozen base hits off Feller in these first two innings. 3-0. The pitch to Hornsby is ball one. 1-1. Hornsby opened the first inning with a triple and scored on the hit by Mays. But here, four consecutive singles. Nobody out, two runs in, third base open. Infield a double play depth. Pitch to Rogers. Hornsby swung on and fouled down the right field line into the lower stands. Hornsby slams his bat and goes back to get a handful of dirt now. The score in this ball game remains 3-0, and they're threatening to make it a bigger inning. Nobody out. Up there leveling that stick, Hornsby. The Raja. Runner at second, Wagner. Runner at first base is Mathewson, wearing a jacket. The pitch is swung on and missed, strike three, and there's Bob Feller with a jug handle curveball, looking for the fastball, and Hornsby got the curve and missed. Feller's third strikeout, but he's still in deep water with one out, third base open, and two runs across, and Stan Musial a batter. The great Cardinal struck out first time, left-hand hitter. Musial with that bat level now. Runners at first and second, infield double play depth. Pitch to Stan is in and over for a strike. Feller with that speed. 0-1. Bobby Feller, who set the sports world on its ear when he started his first major league game in August of 1936 at the age of 16, by striking out 15 St. Louis Browns and missing the American League strikeout record by one. That was in his first major league game, age of 16. Feller pitches to Musial. A ground foul down the third base side and fielded over there in the third base coach's box by the great Fordham Frankie Frisch. All right, two men on, one man out. Stan Musial digs in on that crouch style of his. About to say excuse me as I sit down with that stance. All right, Feller ready. He delivers, swing and a miss, strike three, and Stan goes down for the second straight time. And Feller, shaken by those four hits, steadies now and fans Hornsby and Musial, two out. And the Say Hey Kid, Willie Mays, coming in again. Mays, single, a drive and a run in the first inning. He's up with two on, two in, and two out. Deuces wild. Score is 3-0 National League second inning. Still at second, Wagner at first, Matthews. Feller deals to Mays outside for a ball. Bobby really stiffening by striking out both Hornsby and Musial. Off second is Wagner. Off first base is Mathewson. All right, the delivery to Mays. Swung on, a ground ball past third. This is in the left field for the base hit. Wagner rounding third. Musial up with the ball. Wagner coming in to score, and Mathewson holds it second. Three runs are in. And the hand is for Willie Mays. who has electrified this capacity crowd at Ebbets Field with his second RBI single in two innings. Three runs are in here in the second inning now, and it's a 4-0 National League lead as Mays rockets the ball on the ground past Brooks Robinson. Musial up with it in a hurry, held the runner Mathewson at second, but Mays' second RBI single, and that's five hits off Feller in the inning, seven hits in all, and joining Cy Young out in that bullpen now is Eddie Plank, both of them heating up. But so far, no sign that McGraw, or rather that the American League managing staff, and that's Connie Mack, Casey Stengel, and Joe McCarthy, they're all huddling in that dugout, but they're still going with Feller. Pitch to Melott, over for a strike. A big three-run inning, threatening to make it bigger. There have been five hits, all singles. Mays rocketing that ball past Brooks Robinson. Here's the delivery to Melott. He swings, sends a high fly ball. This one straight away center and should retire the side. Joe DiMaggio coming in. He's under it and makes the catch for the third out. And as the National Leaguers take the field, the fans here in Brooklyn really up on their feet because it was the biggest inning of this second game of the World Series so far. The totals with eight batters up in the second inning. Three runs, five base hits. There were no errors and two men left on. The score after two full innings, National League 4, American League nothing on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.
Thank you, Les, and I'm sure you've noticed too, it's just amazing that Feller has had very little trouble with the left-handed hitters. He's got Musial twice on strikeouts. He got Ott on a strikeout and on a fly ball to center. He got Terry on a fly ball to right. But of the seven hits that he's given up, all seven have been by right-handed hitters. So he's having his troubles with the right-handed hitters as apparently his curveball's not as good as it should be today, and he's had to come in with a fastball and they've hit him. My friends, if you could stage a dream football game for the all-time pro championship, what players would you pick? Naturally, Jimmy Brown. And of course, Johnny Unitas. Were you lucky enough to have been there when Brown broke the 10,000-yard barrier back in 64? Well, now you can recreate that memorable event with a great moment in sports hobby kit by Aurora. Now, each kit features three complete figures in an action-packed scene sculptured in stop motion for super realism. Build the Johnny Unitas kit that shows him passing for his 237th completion in the only sudden-death playoff in National Football League history. A beautiful model, authentic to the last tail, right down to his famous high-top shoes. Build the Jimmy Brown kit. See him once more crashing over the goal line, taking a pair of tacklers along with him for the ride. Unitas and Brown are just two in the series. Build your own sports museum. Aurora Hobby Kits give you the play, the player, and the excitement. Babe Ruth, Jack Dempsey, Willie Mays, Jerry West. Don't just dream about greatness. Make it happen with great moments in sports hobby kits by Aurora. 4-0 ball game at the end of two innings of play. Top of the third, Les Keiter.
Top half of inning number three, Ebbets Field in Brooklyn. Second game of the 1966 Dream World Series. And it's a 4-0 National League lead. Leadoff batter up here in the third is Ty Cobb. Cobb single to right field in the first inning. On the mound, ready to go now with a big lead is Matty. He delivers, pitch swung on, a looping fly out over second, and it's in for the base hit. Drops right in front of Melott, and Ty Cobb gets his second straight hit. He went for the first pitch again, and unlike yesterday, Ty Cobb is really smacking that ball today. Here's Charlie Gehringer, 4-0 lead for the National League. Both teams hitting today. That's a third base hit. And oddly enough, for the American League, their leadoff hitter in each inning has recorded the base blow. Gehringer takes one over for a call strike. We're in the third with a 4-0 lead for Mathewson, and they say down through the years, Matty was always tough when he was ahead. He was a pitcher who coasted, always keeping something in reserve, a style that is no longer possible because of the condition of baseball. But he said he had no particular interest in a low-hit game. Once had a shutout with 14 hits allowed. Pitch to Charlie, a swing and a miss, strike two, as Matty poured that ball in on the handle. Mathewson, of course, famous for the fadeaway pitch, which later became a screwball in baseball. Thrown by a right-hander, breaking away from a left-hander and in on a right-hand batter. And he was the first one to master the delivery. Pitch to Gehringer is swung and a miss, strike three, and there's that fadeaway. Gehringer, left-hand batter. That ball broke away from him. One out, and that strikeout for Mandy number two in this ballgame. One away with Babe Ruth coming in now. Ruth fanned in the first inning. They got the power, Ruth and Garrick. One out, one on, third inning, and the score 4-0 National League. Babe looks at a curve that's up by the chin. Ball one. Christy Mathewson with that rosin sack. Kicks him out of it, does a little landscape work. Tyrus Cobb over there at first, one away. He's not going to try any stealing with a four-run deficit. All right, the pitch to Babe Ruth. He swings and sends the ball to the opposite field. A big, high, drifting fly to left. Musial going back on the ball. He's under it with plenty of room and makes the catch. Babe Ruth hit to left field, hitting late, and hit a high, lazy fly to left. Two away. Here's Lou Gehrig, who grounded out in the first. Old piano legs. Boy, he's got legs like tree trunks. Lou Gehrig with two down and a runner at first in the third. Pitch to Gehrig, swung on, and he sends a one-hopper to Bill Terry. And the first baseman will handle this one all by himself in time to retire the side. And after Cobb's single, they leave him stranded for the second straight time. No runs, one hit, no errors, and a man left. We go to the bottom of the third inning, and it's the National League 4, the American League nothing on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.
Now let's hear this word from Prestone.
Never pick up a stranger. Pick up Prestone Antifreeze. Never pick up a stranger. Don't put your car in danger. Now's the time, the right time to change her. Pick up Prestone Antifreeze.
Get total protection with Prestone Antifreeze. Prestone Antifreeze, with its exclusive magnetic film, protects against freeze-ups, against rust and corrosion. Substitutes just aren't the same. So remember,
never pick up a stranger. Don't put your car in danger. Now's the time, the right time to change her. Pick up Prestone Antifreeze.
Never pick up a stranger. Pick up Prestone Antifreeze. Prestone Antifreeze coolant is a product of Union Carbide.
We go to the bottom of the third inning. On the wire tonight, Pittsburgh and Philadelphia were rained out. They'll play a doubleheader tomorrow. The St. Louis Cardinals playing host to the Los Angeles Dodgers. Their game will start in 5 minutes, and we'll keep you up to date on that one. Now let's go back to the Dream World Series and find out what the Cardon computer says about the bottom of the third inning. Here's Les Kiter.
Bill Terry leads off the bottom of the third. Les Kiter at Ebbets Field, Brooklyn, with game two in the 66 Dream World Series. Ball one as the first pitch by Feller is low. Terry fly to right the first time up. Bob Feller. Brought along slowly, but in the year 1939, recognized as the most sensational pitcher since Walter Johnson. Without the flair and color of a Disney, but with a fastball and youth making him a standout. Feller delivers to Terry, who swings and sends a bouncer to the mound. One hop to Feller. He turns, flips to first, and gets the first man. Terry bounces out 1-3. The National League put five hits together in the second inning for the big three-run inning. They lead 4-0. Here's Trainer, who opened it all with a line single on the first pitch in the second inning. Hi, Trainer, your hitter. And Feller's first pitch is a curveball, strike call. One away. Trainer, who did his playing, of course, with the Pirates in Pittsburgh. Crowds have played a bit as Bob Feller's delivery is swung on and lifted high to center field, not too deep. Willie Mays' counterpart out there, DiMaggio, coming in. He's under it and makes a catch, two out. Trainer with a lazy fly to center, two up, two down, as Feller, who had trouble in the second inning, tries to settle down now. They called Feller as a youngster a typical American boy. If he hadn't been a baseball star, they said he might have won prizes, exhibiting a prize heifer in a 4-H club. He was a picture of health right out of a farm in Van Meter, Iowa, always modest and unassuming. But he knew he was a great pitcher and accepted the talent gracefully as a youngster. Delivers to Campanella, low ball one. Bill Clem, who's working at third today, was asked who, in his opinion, had the best fastball in baseball, and he answered without hesitation, young Bob Feller, and I've seen them all, Johnson, Alexander, Vance, none throw a ball as fast as Feller. Bobby working now on Roy Campanella. Pitch is way high, ball two. 2-0 on Campy. Campanella in yesterday's ball game Had himself a good day at the plate, but 2 for 5, and he singled infield in the second inning today. Almost got a leg on Feller with a sharp ball. Pitch to Roy is over for strike 2-1. 2 men out, third inning. The score here is 4-0 National League, and they're trying to get something started with 2 down on Feller. Bob delivers to Campy over his head, almost threw it away, ball 3, 3-1. Now Berra comes out in front of the mound, hollers something to Bobby, who grabs it one-handed, goes to the rosin sack. He didn't want to throw that pitch. Rapid Robert Feller working in Ebbets Field against the National League All-Stars. Game number 2 in the 66 Dream World Series. He delivers to Campanella, and it's outside. He lost him, ball 4. So Roy Campanella is on again with the base on balls, the first one that Bob Feller has given up here today. And with 2 down, it brings up the Flying Dutchman, Honus Wagner, who singled infield in the second inning in that big inning. Wagner, the batter, with 2 down, runner at first. All right, on the mound, Bob Feller delivers. Pitch swung on, there's a line drive. Deep to left field, Cobb back. Boom, up against the wall. It's in for extra bases. Campanella heading for third. Cobb up at the wall, here comes Campy for the plate. The throw coming all the way in. And Roy Campanella scores standing up. Oh, baby, did Wagner get the wood on that fastball. He sent a line smash to the wall. Cobb leaped. You know, there's a 10-foot wall in front of that double-deck stand. The ball hit the barrier, kicked toward left center. And by the time Ty Cobb could field the ball, he fired it all away, but it was finally too late. Campanella scored standing, 1 run is in, and the National League fattens its lead, and it's now a 5-0 ball game. A double for Wagner and an RBI for Honus Wagner. And now it will be the pitcher, Christy Mathewson, getting the hand as he comes out of the dugout. Matty singled for 2 runs in that big second inning. I'll tell you, that speed of Bobby Feller is being greeted like an old friend by these National League hitters. That's a total of 8 base hits in this ball game, 2 extra base blows. And you know, one oddity, we have had a lot of hits and a lot of runs. We've yet to have a home run in this Dream World Series. All right, here's Mathewson. Swings at the first pitch, strike 1. Boy, oh boy, did Honus Wagner send one out there to the barrier. In Wagner's overall career, of course, he was not known as a home run hitter particularly. But he had a lot of extra base hits. He wrapped that double all the way to the barrier. Honus Wagner up there now on second with 2 down. Pitch to Mathewson, swung on. There's a bouncer to shortstop. Rizzuto coming in, fields the ball, throws to first in time to retire the side. And with the double by Wagner, who had 651 of them in his career, he only had 101 in the home run department overall. But he drives in this run. And on the infield out, 6-3 by Mathewson. Rizzuto throwing the ball over to Gehrig. It retires the National League in the third inning with 1 run. 1 hit. No errors, the man left. And at the end of 3 complete now, it's the National League All-Stars 5. The American League nothing on this, the 1966 Dream World Series.